How are you celebrating the new year? Well, some 35,000 people will be in Las Vegas to hear Barbara Streisand perform. At up to $1,000 each, the tickets for two performances sold out in 2 hours. She is a phenomenon, singer, actress, composer, producer, director, writer, yet she still describes herself to us as a work in progress, searching for another way to make an impact. She was a star at 21 and still today probably one of the greatest all-around talents alive. She rarely does interviews, so sit back and enjoy Barbara Streisand.
People who need people.
Barbara Streisand has been singing about people for the past 30 years. But the reality is, with the exception of a few close friends, Streisand has avoided the public at large. Now there's been a change. She's not only giving up fear, but even her possessions.
First be a person who needs people.
She has donated her Malibu home to the state of California, and she's put much of her beloved Art Nouveau furniture up for auction. It was at Christie's Auction House in New York that we met her.
When I saw this in a window, I thought it was the most beautiful lamp. By the way, the base isn't lit up. I thought, I think this is Tiffany's most beautiful base.
But why are you selling all of these things that you spent years and years collecting? I mean, here's Christie's Auction House. It's all here, your home.
I'm trying to simplify my life.
Barbara Streisand began collecting these beautiful things in her early 20s with the first money she earned. Today, they're valued at over $4 million. She's in New York to prepare for the sale of her collection.
I used to relate more to inanimate objects than I did to real people. I think I'm more into real people. This was one of Tiffany's greatest lamps, the spider web. This was sat in my dining room. This was in my living room. This chair, this same chair, I saw in a book on Sarah Bernhardt. So she had this chair. I mean, isn't that spooky? We have the same initials, but backwards. I think it's so beautiful. It's called the Ombelle. This is the original Ombelle embroidery. And I don't want to give it up. When I see it, it is so beautiful that I think, why am I doing this? I have to remember, okay, trying to let go, trying to clean out.
That. Streisand has just finished decorating her New York apartment with her new passion, 18th century American furniture, the same period as the furniture in the White House. And for the past few years, she has been intensely studying and collecting these beautiful antiques. In fact, she asked that we recreate this period for our interview. So overnight, Christie's Auction House filled this hotel suite with precious early American antiques. Streisand personally checked all of the details. She even checked my lighting, giving us a real demonstration of her keen director's eye.
Right.
How's my lighting?
Well, I think we could get rid of a few shadows if you want me to.
So what do we do?
If you could move the light, if that would be okay. Let me see. You moved it a little bit more? Let's see. I want to see the light in her eyes. Yeah, yeah. That's good. That's better. That's much better. Yeah.
Are we happy?
Yeah.
Thank you. Now my turn. One of your very close friends who writes a lot of your songs, Marilyn Bergman, said, Barbara is coming out of her cocoon. She's been in a cocoon for years, and she's coming out of her cocoon.
Well, it is interesting. I'd rather read newspapers now than scripts. I'm more interested in the real world rather than the world of make-believe. In the world of make-believe, I control things.
Mm-hmm.
I can write the happy ending. I can make it come out the way I want. I'm sort of fascinated with real life.
Are you
real
telling
problems.
Me that you're not going to try to control anymore, that Barbara Streisand can say, I'll just let it happen the way it happens?
Well, I go by, I say this to myself a lot, which has helped me through the last few times I've been performing, mm-hmm. which is to get me out of my fear, which is mm-hmm. let go and let God. And I'm nervous even doing this interview.
I know you are.
I'd like to, you know, acknowledge the fear, but do it anyway. And that has motivated me my whole life.
You know, in in one of your songs, in the new album, there's a song that says, everybody says don't, forgive me if I start
to sing, right?
Everybody says don't, but I say do.
Right. That's my philosophy.
I can't remember an album of yours in which there isn't a song that says, they said I couldn't do it, but I could do it.
That's what feels very familiar. You know, whether it's cut your nose off, cut your nails off, cut your, capture your teeth, you know, change your name, change your face, change your this.
You're wrong, they're right, you should change.
Well, the truth is that there are things that are right for me. They may not be right for you or anyone else, but I go by my instinct.
There hasn't been a musical star this great since Judy Garland. But way back in 1963, Streisand's talent was so remarkable that even performing with Garland, she walked away with the show.
Happy day, I'm here again.
Not only this incredible voice, but acting and directing as well. In fact, today she's one of the most in-demand directors. However, along the way, she gave up singing publicly, out of fear, she says. The only time she has sung publicly has been for charitable or political causes, such as this concert in 1986, which raised money for Democratic senatorial candidates.
Could it be? Yes, it could. Something's coming, something good. If I can wait, something's coming. I don't know what it is, but it is gonna be great.
You were singing publicly, not for charity, for the first time in 20 years. You who were terrified.
27 years.
27 years.
Well, in a concert, but okay. 20 years. In, yeah.
Terrified of singing publicly. Now you're going to be doing New Year's Eve concerts at MGM Grand in Las Vegas.
It's a 15,000 seat theater, you know.
But why now? You haven't faced these fears,
right.
You just told me. 27 years.
There are many reasons. I think it's a challenge, you know. I think my fans, the public, they want to see me perform. It's almost like something they feel I withhold from them, and in a way, maybe I was. I've also given up a certain part of my perfectionism. In other words, I cannot be perfect.
They're paying you $20 million.
Well, that's a rumor. I'm not going to tell you because
okay.
I don't
but
believe
in discussing. But it's a huge amount, the highest amount that's ever been paid for such a performance. Does that matter?
Well, it's very flattering. It was like, wow, you would pay me that? Like, even my mother said, why do they pay you so much to sing?
That's everybody's mother. You?
Why do they pay you so much? I guess they like me, Mom, and they want me. But
did she really say, why do they pay you so much to sing?
Yeah, why would they pay you so much to sing? But that's not the point. The thing, basically, is that I was ready to sing. I was ready to face this kind of fear, in a sense. Mm-hmm. The other thing is that I hate New Year's Eve. I've never liked it. This was perfect. I can avoid it and yet be doing something that's, you know, that's good to do.
While we're talking about performing, there have been rumors that you may go on a world tour. Any possibility?
Well, I think that I want to see how I like doing this.
And if you like
it? Take two nights at a time.
Yeah.
If I like it, I might do that. Because it's a way of touching people and have them touch me.
In general, in the last couple of years, you've spoken out much more. I mean, this woman who doesn't like to talk to the press, this woman who leads a very private life, you've talked to women's groups. Mm-hmm. You were very much in the forefront last year when Colorado had their anti-gay law. Are you sorry you did that? Because
No,
you.
No. I am against discrimination of any kind. And this is an amendment that is discriminatory.
Just look at the Vote for Hate in Colorado, where voters rescinded any protection for gays in employment or housing.
Streisand has often spoken out on issues she feels strongly about.
We must accept the fact that all human beings deserve dignity and respect and basic human rights.
She's not only spoken out, but she's taken action. In 1986, she founded the Streisand Foundation, and in the past 7 years, she's given away over $7 million to causes and charities she believes in, like the environment, women's issues, civil liberties, civil rights, and AIDS. She says this is her way of coping with the huge problems she sees everywhere in the world.
And now, it is my honor and great pleasure to introduce to you the 42nd President of the United States, Bill Clinton.
Streisand has also been politically active since the early 70s, supporting and raising funds for Democratic candidates all the way up to the presidency.
God bless America, my heart, sweet heart, please.
She sang at President Clinton's inaugural gala and then spent time in Washington sightseeing and meeting with the President and Mrs. Clinton and with officials like the then chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Colin Powell. The press slammed her. They called Hollywood people airheads. The New York Times even criticized her inauguration outfit. And the New York Post claimed she was running for office, even though she denied it when they asked her about it.
I don't have political ambition. We were invited to this correspondence dinner, and we became the main course. In other words, the press, they're interested in drama, in theatrics. I thought it was terribly unfair to invite us there only to trash us. And then you have the cynicism that comes out, because it's the first time in my whole life I had the time to spend a few days in Washington to see the things that I absolutely adore. Now I'm in Washington, I can finally visit Monticello, Thomas Jefferson's house. I went down to the basement of the National Archives and held George Washington's inaugural address in my hands. I held the Monroe Doctrine. I looked at the Louisiana Purchase, the Emancipation Proclamation. This was thrilling to me. To visit the White House is thrilling. And there's a sense of awe and history and importance. And I don't understand why that is looked at with a cynical attitude. I'm a student. I'm a perpetual student. I will always be a student.
Papa, are you near me? Papa, can you hear me? Papa, can you help me not be frightened?
Starting with Yentl, she began producing, directing, and starring in films which reflect issues in her own life. Her great interest these days is directing.
Let's talk about your films. The kind of films that you are choosing now to direct or produce or star in are different from the ones you did in the past where you were the comic or you sang. Mm-hmm. Now they seem to have a message. Mm-hmm. Do they? Are they chosen for that reason?
I think it's very difficult to direct movies because they take many years of one's life.
So what you're saying is if you do something now, it's got to be more important than just
a... Everything I do entails hard work. And yet, I don't want to trivialize fun and comedy. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the movies I'm working on is called The Mirror Has Two Faces, and it's about the illusion of love. I guess I've always been fascinated by the mystery of appearances. You know, what people look like on the exterior and what's really going on inside.
What do you look like on the outside and what's on the inside, since you brought it up? Nice, easy question. You think you're good looking?
At times, I think I am.
Sexy?
At times.
Pretty?
At moments. Times.
And inside?
Gurgling. It's thrashing around in there.
The image that Streisand has of herself isn't always how other people see her. She has her share of critics, and tonight she will answer them. She'll also look back and see the painful memories that still haunt her and what's in her future. More of Barbra Streisand coming up.
Are the luckiest people
from ABC News, 2020 continues. Once again, Hugh Downs.
Continuing Barbara's interview with Barbara, few people talk about Barbra Streisand without saying that she has a difficult personality. And yet, for the most part, she's worked with the same people throughout her career. She's had a stable private life. She's never abused drugs or alcohol, hasn't had a string of marriages, and is surrounded by lifelong friends. Now, true, she wants it all to produce, direct, and star. But so do many men in the business. So why is she singled out for criticism? Streisand has her own explanation of that.
A man is forceful, a woman is pushy. A man is assertive, she's aggressive. He strategizes, she manipulates. He shows leadership, she's controlling. He's committed, she's obsessed. It's been said that a man's reach should exceed his grasp. Why can't that be true for a woman?
Let me talk about some of the adjectives that one reads about again and again. Controlling. Obsessive.
Boring.
Yeah. Okay. But A, is
isn't it fashionable, fashionable to be controlling these days, no? You see, I don't find them insulting. I find it a compliment. My son was very articulate in a magazine about me. He was saying something about, I don't understand why my mother's wanting things to be right is a criticism. Why? Because she cares. Is that something wrong?
But Barbara, you are controlling. It does matter to you.
It does matter to me. I think that because I can't control life, I can't control people, I can't control my art. When I'm making a movie, and I have a very specific idea of how it should be, mm-hmm. Let's say in Prince of Tides, I had all kinds of a very difficult camera setup to try to get the sun at the same time as the moon. So there were days we were filming in the camera, I was up to my pupik, as they say, that's my belly button, in English.
Sound like the old Barbara 20 years ago.
I am the old Barbara, and I'm the new Barbara. I'm all the Barbaras. And then I couldn't get this shot, you know, and then I said, well, let's see what the universe is presenting. Let me use what is. And then all of a sudden, I remember just thinking, please, there was no sun out. There was no sunset. And I just said, just let me have a little sunset. I'll give up this other thing. And I just sort of prayed very hard. And all of a sudden, the sun emerged out of the clouds, and we had this most beautiful shot. It was a gift.
Are you easier on yourself? I mean, you're so hard on yourself, and you're sometimes very hard on others in your desire to have it just right.
Let me say this. I have a long way to go. I have a lot to learn. I want to feel like I've got to help better the world in some way. I've got to be of service, because this enriches my soul. This fills me up. It makes me feel good. But I also know that I wish I were more compassionate, that I were more loving. I mean, if we could only love thy neighbor as thyself, if that just one thought could be adhered to, I mean, wouldn't this world be a much better place? Like, we cannot change the world. It's such an overwhelming feat. But yet, by changing ourselves, each of us in a very small way, we change the world.
When you talk about love and love in general, do you want at this point in your life to be married? Is that something
you know,
that you
why
think
do you
about?
Keep asking me this question?
Because, you know, it's the kind of thing that I know people want to know. I ask you every time I see it. And you haven't. You had one marriage when you were very young. And
right.
People want to know about that. People who care about you want to know a little about you. You know that.
Because it's, I think all people, including me, want to connect.
So the answer is yes, maybe.
No, there's not a maybe.
The
answer is, of course. I believe in marriage and the institution of marriage.
You've waited a long time.
Hasn't been right yet.
Some say that Streisand has always been looking for her father, who died when she was just a baby. Her mother remarried when Barbara was about 7 years old to a man who virtually ignored the young child. The lack of a male figure in her life is something Streisand has explored in various films.
Part of also what you have, it seems to me, been talking about in the letting go is the dealing with the past.
Mm-hmm.
And you've talked a good deal about
uh-huh.
the fact that your
yeah.
father died when you were...
15 months.
15 months. Do you think you'd be a very different woman had he lived?
Oh, sure.
How?
I might not have been an artist. I might not have had the need to express myself, to live in my imagination, and I might have had a whole other life.
What you're saying is that if he had been there to nourish you so that you didn't have to live within yourself and prove yourself,
mm-hmm.
this kind of drive might not have been there. You would have been a different girl.
Probably. You see, because I felt very unseen as a child, unlistened to, you know? I just never feel like I was paid any attention.
Your mother didn't give you that either.
I don't want to cause my mother any pain. My mother's going to be 85 years old. And, you know, in a sense, she did the best she could. And without her pushing me into, let's say, the school system, it might not have sparked this rebellion inside of me to do something the opposite. So in a way, you know, we are the products of our childhood.
Have you come to peace with your stepfather, who never knew you were there, to whom you said to me 8 years ago, I never had a conversation with?
Is that on your show?
Mm-hmm.
I never had a conversation with him, no.
Did your stepfather live to see you a success?
It's interesting because I was in Funny Girl, I think I was 21 or 22 years old. I hadn't seen him. He and my mother separated when I was 13. I heard he was coming to see me in Funny Girl, and I did the performance for my stepfather. And he sent me a basket of candies that I guess it was 2 years ago, I threw out the jar. I said, why am I keeping this from this man?
Did he ever say anything to you? He say you're wonderful?
I don't remember words like that.
But for 2 years you kept, for 20 years you kept his candy. Not that it had any meaning in your life, not that you cared, not that it mattered,
no.
But for 20 years you kept the candy.
And then just threw it out and said, you know, I don't need this anymore.
Is there anything that you want to do that you haven't?
Oh,
the
yeah,
acting
lots of things.
Is there,
the
singing is there.
I'd like to direct a Broadway play. I also love the classics. I'd still love to do sometime Strindberg, Chekhov, Ibsen, Shakespeare. All the things I loved as a child, as a 15, 16-year-old young actress who, you know, knew exactly how I wanted to play Romeo and Juliet. Well, now I'll get to direct someone else in it, but with my concept of how it should be played.
That tough question. How do you want to be remembered? Director? Actress? Singer? What?
All of the above.
What would you like it to say?
She contributed something to the world.
Yeah, she did.
Certainly contributed a lot of pleasure and entertainment.
Why was she so terrified of singing publicly all those years?
The fear of making a mistake, the need to be perfect. She's trying to become much more spiritual, I think. You can hear it in what she says. And when she says, I'm trying to let go and let God, she still tries to control, but she's trying to give that up and reach out.
Might that change things? She said she hadn't found the right man yet to remarry. Might that change?
Well, she was married to Elliot Gould when she was very young. They have a grown son, Jason, whom they're both very devoted to. There have been rumors that she's been involved with the tennis player, Andre Agassi. She says they're just great friends. And privately, she's very vulnerable. And,
maybe she wants to let well enough alone.
Yeah, you know, I hope she does find...
But do you think she really is different now?
She's trying. I mean, she still is the perfectionist. She still... Everything has to be just right. You know, she has that inner ear and that eye. But she's trying, and she is much more interested in the world around her. That's a change.
Interesting personality and a powerhouse talent, of course. Thank you, Barbara.